Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of my colleagues at the Institute of South Asian Studies, I'm delighted to welcome you all. The four walls within which this conversation is taking place do not belong to us. We are not home. We are next door, the next building. And by arrangement of the UNDP, we use this auditorium. But those of you who have come from a long way, this particular corner of the NUS is not easy to reach. Now that you have come this far, my hope is you will come also to our seminars, which are held in our own building. What I'm going to do in the minutes that have been allocated to me, to tell you a little about what this workshop is about, and why we are holding it, and what I see as one of the main problematics that should come up for our conversation in this very intense day of discussions. The proposed workshop will discuss and compare the cross-country findings of the state of democracy in South Asia. It's a project which started in 2004-05, and it was started by a group of South Asian scholars who had come together to make the first ever comparative study of democracy spanning five countries of South Asia: India, Bangladesh, Nepal, Pakistan, and Sri Lanka. Some of you might have seen the results of the first wave. I brought in my own battered copy. I will put it on the table if you want to have a look at what the first generation produced, and that will give you an idea of what the second generation is in the process of doing and presenting here. This workshop will focus on the outcomes of the second round, and the country level findings will be presented by the individual scholars, and they will discuss essentially citizens' ideas, expectations, perceptions, and their evaluation of democracy in their countries, as well as the idea of democracy in general. As you all know, democracy is deceptively simple to measure. Actually, as a political scientist, I find it much easier to work on dictatorship. I mean, we all have an idea of when people in power become dictatorial. But when it comes to democracy, it's much harder, because you are not being democratic if you don't let people be what they want to be, and what they want to be often results in denying the rights to others that they give themselves. So very quickly, democracies can become self-defeating. And if you're talking about measuring democracies in different countries on the basis of the same design, which is what this project is doing, it gets even more complicated, and for that reason, even more interesting. It's particularly significant for this project that this is evidence-based research and is not merely based on impressions. The core questions stem from the three challenges that democracy faces typically, and in the previous studies they have performed key questions. They are the foundational challenge: how did democracy come to be established, the consolidation challenge, and the expansion and deepening challenge. And as again from past we know, Pakistan historically faced the challenge of founding democracy as a system of governance, while Nepal has been facing this challenge in the second decade. Both Bangladesh and Pakistan in contemporary times face the challenge of consolidation of democracy. At the same time, Sri Lanka and India, which have had a much longer acquaintance and experimentation with democracy, they have been limited by majoritarian trends, particularly in Sri Lanka, while in India it is limited by institutional and governance failures. And a typical question to ask is India as democratic in Kashmir as in Maharashtra? It's still the same country. Hence, one part of the core question today is the gap between the acceptance of democracy as a precept and the experience of democracy in everyday life, in practice. On the other hand, the limited practice and the qualified acceptance of democracy in South Asia nevertheless contributes to the theorization of democracy. We often ask, when we're feeling particularly patriotic, do we need a Western model? Can't we have our own model? Well, there is time for third worldism, there is time for being comparative. What this research is doing is to produce new evidence to test old models as they travel. The speakers are Professor Sandeep Shastri, Suhas Balsikar from India, Krishna Hachetur from Nepal, S.K. Tafik from Bangladesh, and Pradeep Iris from Sri Lanka. The biographies have been circulated. I'm very honored and privileged, dear colleagues, to welcome you all here. I'm also very privileged and very pleased to welcome Professor Kanti Bajpayee, the Wilmer Professor of Asian Studies from the LKY School of Public Policy, later Professor Vinita Sinha, Head of Department, Head of Study of South Asian Studies Program, would also be joining. Then a quick word on why we in the South Asian Institute are undertaking this project. Now, the Institute of South Asian Studies, ISAS, has a mandate which requires it to connect Singapore to contemporary South Asia. Now, this connecting of South Asia brings me to the issue of democracy. Because after all, if you are going to connect the countries to contemporary politics, what is the guarantee that the connection, the signing of contracts, will be respected by the next government? Or in other words, to give a long-term nature to any relationship, we have to ask, are these countries, are these states resilient? Is there a system where successive generations will honor the commitments made by this generation? You can't take contemporary South Asia seriously, therefore, if you don't take their politics seriously. My objective has been always to think of Singapore-South Asia relations or connecting the dynamism of Singapore with the vitality and potential of South Asia for it to be a two-way flow. What has Singapore discovered? After all, for those who are here for the first time, look at this lovely high-rise buildings, garden city. It was not like that 50 years ago. In one generation, they have achieved a lot. Now, what does that achievement signify for South Asia? What can travel? Or for that matter, how does South Asia sort out the problem of transforming subjects into citizens, authoritarian colonial rule into democracy, and how do they survive both in terms of remaining democratic while turning around from hardcore poverty towards liberalization and globalization? How do the democratic shifts repair the little leakages in their democracy without ceasing to be democratic? After all, South Asia is a great laboratory, and this comparative study has therefore deep significance, I think, not only for democratic theory, but for public policies that Singapore follows. My institute has mandate from two ministries, Ministry of Foreign Affairs and Ministry of Trade and Industry, our two main anchor points within Singapore government, to connect. I always therefore say that ISAS must, on every issue, ask two questions. What is in it for Singapore? What is in it for research? And I think for this, democracy is eminently suited to show how Singapore can connect to Amaravati, or for that matter to Madhya Pradesh, how Singapore can be a partner to Bangladesh and a number of other emerging projects within South Asia. And each of these involves South Asian politics. I have learned this from Professor Riaz Hassan, my colleague from Australia, of Pakistani origin, and I'll never forget him. I was new. He said, Shubhat, I'll never forget. Of course, we talk economics. But behind economics is politics. Behind politics are people. And behind people are cultures and memories. So you can't just take the economics and forget the rest. You have to look at the whole package. And that's what democracy research does. And while we're at it, policy analysis forces theory to face up to contemporary reality. Because theorists sometimes forget that as concepts travel across national frontiers, sometimes they are a victim of lost baggage. They shed the cultural context and the history in which they were produced. So, democrats, when they're not thinking about it, end up by becoming sort of secular missionaries to democratize whether the objects of democracy want it or not. Send them bombs, send them foreign aid. So the mission of democratization, mission of modernization, might sometimes also acquire the shape of occupying armies. That's where South Asian research must play a very important role in the age of rising intolerance. How does South Asia do it without the benefit of NATO troops coming to occupy it? That again is another reminder. How to talk about democracy without adjectives? Democracy without adjectives is a big challenge, because while you are at it, you'd see democracy must give the unrestricted and universal domain to the individual making choices. What if those choices involve reviving pre-modern cultures deeply linked to a particular religion? How does a democracy translate in deeply divided societies to multiculturalism or majoritarian intolerance? So you would say, this is not being very liberal. The moment you have said it, you have gotten into democracy with adjectives, and you are forgetting that liberalism was born elsewhere in a different century, where those who survived liberalization of the economy, many didn't survive, many minorities didn't survive, went on to have a bit of democracy. And in the state nations that South Asia has, you can't very well say, in the name of democracy, we cannot put up with these intolerant minority groups or these intolerant poverty and so on. So how do you keep everyone on board, give everyone the right to vote, and yet produce coherent, systematic politics which gives rights to everyone? So if we are looking for democracy without adjectives, we have a big problem in our hands. And once again, I'm very grateful, particularly to Professor Shwas Patsika. I'm so sorry that Sanjay is not able to join us for reasons of health. When Shwas approached me and said that, Shubhata, let's share these findings in Singapore, I was delighted. That was one of the reasons I myself moved from Heidelberg to Singapore. Because from here, not only are we closer to South Asia, we are closer to all South Asian countries at the same time. Because such a conversation in Delhi or Islamabad would acquire a national character. From here, we can be equidistant and produce a level playing field, by the way, of our cultural conversation today. It's going to be a very intensive day, so I'll not take much longer. I am simply requesting the authors to take 15 minutes at lunchtime so that we can get together and talk a little about the paper that we'll publish. Because ISAS has committed itself to publishing very quickly the results of this conference to give them a long-term access worldwide. We have a distribution list of 9,000 people. Maybe the reading numbers are even more. So we will try to clean the main results, put them on the net very quickly, and then our authors will come up with some papers which will be published. And then they will, of course, go ahead and do something substantial, like this is the first generation study. And we'll all, students of democracy, be eagerly looking forward to those findings. With this, thank you very much for your attention. I will now pass it on to the chair of the next session, Dr. Ranuja Sen.
Thank you, Dr. Savitra, for the introduction to both democracy as it has traveled to South Asia and why ICES is organizing this particular conference. Just to continue from where Dr. Savitra left, we showed you the earlier volume which came out in the State of Democracy Survey. I should hasten to add a very handsomely produced volume with some very striking illustrations as well as visuals. So it doesn't really have a fine list of evidence, but it's also a visual feast for the eyes. And a few big ideas in the reports, and maybe I should flag that before starting on this panel. And here I quote from the report itself. One was that the idea of democracy has transformed South Asia as much as South Asia has transformed the idea of democracy itself. The second idea that focus on this. Democracy in South Asia did not take a preordained path. A third, politics continues to be one of the most vibrant forces shaping contemporary South Asia. A fourth, South Asia people's orientations to democracy are shaped principally by political experience rather than their inherited identity, a very important one. Fifth, the strength of the practice of democracy in South Asia lies in its capacity to move away from the received model of democracy. And finally, the encounter between South Asian culture, democracy, and the largely imported institutions have resulted in a bifurcation of and within institutions. So with these few words, it's my pleasure to invite you to the panelists for this session. Although this session is titled as one being on India, Professor Shastri will actually really focus on the findings on India for the latest survey, and Professor Bhashikar will actually dwell on some of the larger theoretical issues, which are not really confined to India itself, but are relevant for South Asia. You have the detailed bios of the speakers, so I won't go into the entire resume. But Professor Shastri, as some of you are aware, is the co-vice chancellor of Jain University. He's also director of the Center for Research in Social Science and Education at the same university. He's authored over 10 books. He contributes regularly to leading Indian newspapers. He's also the national coordinator of Lokmiti, which coordinated both the earlier State of Democracy in South Asia project as well as the Commonwealth. The title of his paper is Public Perceptions on the Working of Democracy in India, the Gulf Between Promise and Performance. Would you like to present from there?
Thank you,
Dr.
Sen. At the outset, let me use this opportunity to thank the National University of Singapore and the Institute of South Asian Studies for this opportunity to be here. I have titled this presentation as the Public Perception on the Working of Democracy in India. Much of what I'm going to say is drawn from this report that we have actually published, a report called Democracy in India, which brings out the major findings of the survey that we did in India. The picture of that book is also flagged there as part of the slide. Now, what are the major issues that I'd like to flag as part of this presentation? As I said, the issues I would raise as part of this presentation flow from the India report, which has just been released. And the India report forms part of the State of Democracy in South Asia study, the second phase of that study. As Professor Mitra rightly mentioned earlier, the first phase of the State of Democracy in study in South Asia was done in 2005. And got published as a work which Professor Mitra showed all of us in 2008. The second phase of the State of Democracy in South Asia was initiated by all of us in 2011. And we did the surveys in Nepal, Sri Lanka, Pakistan, Bangladesh, and India in 2013. And this time around, we chose a slightly different route for doing our study. We first have come up with country-specific reports. All the 5 countries have published their reports on the findings of the survey. And now we are moving to the next stage of the study where we are coming up with the comprehensive South Asia report. I also must draw your attention to the fact that the State of Democracy in South Asia survey also becomes part of what is termed the South Asia Barometer, which is a part of the Global Barometer survey. The same survey is part of the larger Global Barometer studies. Now, if you look at the India component of the study, this time around, the India component of the study basically focused attention on 4 critical areas or 4 critical facets. What was the support for democracy among the citizens? What is the nature of democratic orientation of the citizens? What is the intensity of support for democracy and the meaning of democracy? Professor Mitra rightly raised the question that does South Asia and do studies in South Asia bring to the table of democracy a new perspective on understanding democracy? We tried to put it a little rhetorically in our first SDSA report, where we said one of our aims is to democratize the understanding of democracy by trying to bring on to the table how does or how do the citizens of this region actually look at the democratic process. And in this report, an attempt has been to take that particular analysis forward. The report also looks at the various strands of political participation as perceived by the voter. The nature and intensity of trust in different political and non-political, elected and non-elected institutions. And finally, how do citizens in India look at the whole system of governance and service delivery. So these were the 4 or 5 dimensions from which this round of the survey looked at popular perceptions. And let me take on each of these issues a few points for discussion. To start off with, I think the image of democracy which comes out from this survey and the imagination of democracy as seen in the perceptions of the people require us to actually flag 4 important issues. There is this very, very strong temptation to compare what citizens in the country said in 2005 and what they said 6 to 8 years later in 2013. And then to draw immediate conclusions and say X has changed, Y has improved, Z is just as it was. And we would like to add a word of caution there before that direct comparison is done, because at the end of the day, I think context matters. In all our countries, we did the survey in 2013. And it's important to flag the point that 2013 had a very distinct political orientation in each of our countries. And I'm sure my friends from Nepal, Sri Lanka, and Bangladesh will also highlight this fact that in 2013, when you look at people in India responding to certain issues on politics, they are often reflecting on the nature of politics that they see around them at that given point of time. And that fact, I think, cannot be really lost sight of. So in some senses, we are capturing the moment as citizens saw it at that given point of time when the survey was undertaken. Now, this does not mean that we should not do a comparison over time, but even as we do this comparison over time, this particular factor, I think, will also have to be budgeted into any analysis. One new dimension we brought into our study this time was to look at citizens' perspectives from this larger prism of democratic orientation. We had a series of questions we tried to tap the democratic orientation of people. And for several issues that we looked at as part of the study, this particular democratic orientation forms the basis for a lot of analysis. To begin with, the larger, wider question of the political orientation. It's important to flag the point that the broad proportions of Democrats, people who say we prefer democracy to any other form of government. That has largely remained unchanged. If you look at the figures of 2005 and the figures of 2013, you really see more or less the numbers being the same, 49% and 46%. It's important to mention that the support for authoritarian rule, where some people say in some situations authoritarian rule is also fine. Now, those numbers have actually increased. They have actually doubled, nearly doubled, from 6% to 11%. And the percentage of those, the proportion of those who are indifferent to the whole question, more or less remains the same. Now, again, for many, this would be a sign of a little alarm that over a 8-year period, you do see this slight reduction in the intensity of preference for democracy, and a increase in the preference for authoritarian rule. But then, as I mentioned earlier, I would prefer to look at this from the context of citizens looking at developments in the country in the year 2013 and the implications of that. The other issue that also I'd like to mention at this, sorry.
What's the difference between indifference and no opinion?
Indifference and
no opinion.
When we place a particular category in indifferent, the response is it does not make a difference whether the system is democratic or non-democratic. And the category of no opinion is those who refuse to state their position on that particular. So by indifference, it's meant those who say whether the country pursues democracy or whether the country moves towards authoritarian rule, it really makes no difference to me at all. Now, those who take that position are those who are listed in that 15% in 2005 and 16% in 2013. The other two issues that I'd like to specifically flag in this context is the generic satisfaction with democracy as expressed by the people. Here again, it must be mentioned that compared to 2005, in 2013, the level of satisfaction with democracy sees a 10 percentage point decrease, and the level of dissatisfaction with democracy actually sees a increase to around 37%. It was 15% in 2005. It has risen to 37% in 2013. That is not there as part of a chart, that's why I'm not giving it ahead. And I think this dissatisfaction with democracy in 2013, again for me, is a reflection of how people saw the democratic process functioning around 2011, 12, and 13. And those of us who have looked at Indian politics closely at that point of time would understand the implications of what I'm saying. Moving forward to this whole question of the multiple meanings of democracy, one of the points that we had clearly flagged as part of the 2005 study was that in South Asia, there was a much, much higher privileging of democracy as justice and welfare, much more than as equality and as rights and as rule of law and as elections. A lot of people in the country did see democracy as welfare and justice. And this time around, we have found that citizens who look at democracy, who define democracy in the language of welfare and ensuring freedom, they are the ones who also are much stronger in endorsing the need. They are the ones who look at more the whole question of it resonates much more than the procedural aspect of democracy, the substantive forms of democracy in terms of welfare and freedom is asserted by them much more. Let me also make this point at this stage that there is an open-ended question we ask in the survey, which is, according to you, what is democracy? And whatever the responses that people come up with in their language is actually recorded, and the same is then tabulated and divided into several categories. And we have come up with 7 to 8 categories of responses to how people define democracy. And this whole focus on justice and welfare as a critical element of democracy as perceived by the people is something which we clearly saw in 2055. And again, repeats itself in 2030. The fact that those who adopted or those who had this whole approach of looking at democracy from the perspective of welfare and the perspective of justice tended to also take this position. They were also the ones who had a much stronger pro-democratic orientation. The orientation for preference of democracy was seen much higher among those who took a welfareist and a justice-oriented definition of democracy. I think the a point which I will elaborate on as I proceed further is that I think the expectation amongst the citizens as to what they thought the idea of democracy would actually produce is reflected in the fact that many of them believed that what democracy was seen to promise and what democracy actually delivered in the society, there was this huge hiatus that was there between the two. Another dimension that we looked at as part of the study was, what were the contours of participation by the citizens in processes which could be termed as electoral and non-electoral? And if you look at the graph here, if you will look at this graph, you will notice, save on voting, where more than 86% said that that was an important form of participation. If you leave out voting, there is a tendency for citizens to speak about their participation in non-electoral activities rather than electoral activities. If you look at the second and the third, watching news and following political events in the media, a regular discussion on matters of politics, getting together to raise an issue or a petition, if you look at most of these issues, these are necessarily issues which are of non-electoral activities. So among the election or electoral related activities, you see this very huge gulf between participation and non-participation. So there is this important variation in participation in electoral and non-electoral activities. Are there any demographic differences with regard to this participation? Yes. Participation in electoral activities was significantly higher in rural India as compared to urban India. And if you look at youth, and I must qualify this point that as per Government of India definition of youth, it is those below 34 years of age and not 25 years of age. And if you look at those below 35 years of age in India, participation of youth is significantly higher in non-electoral activities than in electoral activities. And finally, and this is an interesting paradox as we found, with greater electoral participation, there is reduced preference for democracy. If you see those who state that they participate much more in electoral activity, among them you see much more lukewarm response with regard to their preference for democracy. So this was another trend that we found. Those who demonstrated greater cynicism towards democracy also were those who were not seen to be very active in electoral participation. And as I mentioned a moment ago, those with reduced electoral participation those with greater electoral participation were also the ones who were less intense in their support and preference for democracy. This study also looks at two other points. The study has come up with this whole concept of civic participation, and the citizen who tended to participate much more, who tended to take a stronger stand on issues, also was seen to have a much more intense democratic orientation, a much greater support for democratic orientation. The study also looked at popular trust in various political and various elected and non-elected institutions. The good news is that the level of trust in institutions has actually risen in 2013 as compared to 2005. However, it's risen by a marginal 2 percentage points only. A few issues that merit attention here. Much higher trust for non-elected institutions than elected institutions. The level of public trust in non-elected institutions, be it the army, be it the court, be it the army, the court, the civil service, the trust in these were much more than the trust in elected institutions like the central government, state government, local government, parliament, prime minister, president. The trust in these was significantly low. One more point. Compared to 2005, elected institutions fared much worse in terms of trust as compared to non-elected institutions. Overall, the trust levels was higher, but if you were to separate elected and non-elected institutions, the level of trust in elected institutions had actually come down, and the level of trust in non-elected institutions had actually gone up. And a few specificities, a few specifics in that regard. The trust in state governments did not really see much of a difference. The ones which really took a beating were the national government and the local government. The level of trust in the national and local government had gone down. And as was likely to be expected, the political parties were at the bottom of the trust indicators. The lowest level of trust was actually in political parties. One point which continues to intrigue us, and we are not able to really put our finger on the possible reason for that, is one elected institution which saw a phenomenal rise in trust, a 13 percentage point rise in trust, was actually parliament. The trust in parliament from 2005 to now had actually gone up by 13%. And this is something that we are still looking at and trying to analyze more carefully as to what could have contributed to this rise in the trust for parliament. Among the non-elected institutions, of course, the highest level of trust was in the military, 78%, followed by the courts, which was 66%, followed by civil service, 53%, and the last was the police, which was 47%. Two quick points on this. Those who demonstrated greater indifference towards democracy had a much higher level of distrust in elected institutions. Those who were indifferent towards democracy compared to those who registered their preference for democracy showed much, much higher levels of distrust in elected institutions. Those with a democratic orientation as compared to those with a little authoritarian orientation displayed less trust in elected institutions. Two, three other demographic differences. Trust in elected institutions was significantly higher among the upper classes and middle classes, and significantly lower among the scheduled castes and scheduled tribes. Interestingly, among the upper castes, very high trust in parliament, courts, and the police. Not unexpectedly, men tended to trust the army much more than women. In metros, the civil service enjoyed tremendous trust. And finally, if you look at the Muslim community, high levels of trust in the central government, local government, not in the state government, central government, local government, the office of the president and prime minister, and interestingly, high levels of trust in the court. So there are very critical
differences in terms of the level of personal pressure. Thank you. I'm just coming to my summary.
I think the Democracy in India study second round indicates 2-3 very, very important points. I think beyond a shadow of doubt, the citizens in India do celebrate the fact of democracy, the acceptance of democracy. But like we say in our earlier report, I think the second round of our study also shows that there are important challenges which the citizens perceive with regard to whether the deepening of the democratic process is happening. Clearly, I think there is this gap which citizens see between what is the promise of democracy and the actual performance of democracy. There is this puzzle of democratic orientation which I will spend a few minutes that I now have to actually look at. There is this strong pro-democratic orientation and support for a welfare-based, justice-based understanding of democracy among the more marginalized sections of society. Now, this is an important fact that I'd like to highlight. If you look at the privileged sections of society, by privileged I would mean here the socially and economically privileged sections of society, they seem to have higher proportions of people supporting an authoritarian orientation compared to the less privileged who have a much, much higher democratic orientation. With this, you have a contradiction that the elite, in terms of social elite and economic elite, seem to indicate a much greater participation in electoral and non-electoral activity. So is it that this elite which participates much more in electoral and non-electoral activity has a more practical understanding of democracy and therefore are a little more skeptical of how democracy functions? Or is it for them a mask to hide their indifference? My own vote is with the second preference, that this whole, the elite which is believed to participate much more are indifferent to the process, and that indifference expresses itself as skepticism towards democracy. As I said earlier, a pro-democratic orientation is much more among the marginalized sections of society, and this is something which even in our earlier report we highlighted. Finally, we did undertake this exercise of, is there a funnel in terms of support for democracy? How many people say, I believe in democracy? Take out from that those who say, once in a way, dictatorship is okay. Take out from that those who say, army rule is also fine. Take out from that those who say, strong leaders is what the country needs. And take out from that those who say, rule by experts is more important. Before taking out all these, before you thin down the funnel, the overall percentage of those who say, I want democracy, stood at 84% in 2013. That democracy, without taking out all these other options away from the funnel, it was 84%. You remove those who said dictatorship once in a way, authoritarian rule once in a way is okay. Remove those who supported army rule. Remove those who supported strong leadership. Remove those who said rule by experts is fine. It falls from 85% to 23% at the end. Good news, 23% at least is higher than 19% what it was in 2005. The same funnel which we did in 2005, it had come down to 19% in 2005. Now it's actually risen to 23% of what people would call the very strong Democrats, who in spite of these other orientations would not give up their faith in democracy. So I conclude with this, that clearly You do have the acceptance of democracy and the negation of its alternatives. You do have a very strong trust deficit, especially when it comes to elected institutions. You do have the difference between the elite and the masses, where the masses seem to have a greater faith in the capacities of the democratic process as compared to the elite, which I said is largely a reflection of cynicism in the elite and a mask to hide their indifference. So I think in this sense, the study shows the whole approach that citizens in the country have adopted towards democracy, and I think this the whole focus on democratic orientation of citizens provides us a meaningful handle to look at how over the years the democratic process has impacted on how people in the country perceive democracy. Thank you.
For some fascinating insights from the latest survey. Particularly, you know, you talked about the proportion of Democrats having been unchanged, but at the same time, those supporting authoritarianism has risen, and you talked about the funnel effect which is there in your review too. But if you weed out those supporting strong leaders, ruled by experts, authoritarianism, the support for democracy actually falls from roughly 84-85% down to 23%, but you see some hope in the fact that it's risen from 19% in the 2006 survey to 23% in the current round. And you also talked about the context, and I guess in India, when the survey was taking place this is really coming at a time when another anti-corruption movement was taking place, and there was a perception that the national government two was mired in several corruption scandals. So you made the important point that context also matters, and it's somewhat tricky to compare these surveys over time. So that's a very important point. So now I hand over the floor to Mr. Suhas Balshekar, a very familiar name to anyone interested in Indian politics. He currently teaches political science at Savitribai Phule, Pune University. He's also co-director of the Lokniti program and editor-in-chief of the biannual journal Studies in Indian Politics, a regular contributor to the Indian Express, where a lot of us read his columns with great interest. His paper is titled One Role, Different Approaches, Different Experiences, and Different Approaches.
Thank you, Rajan. Sorry, but what he grandly calls paper is not a paper. And also parts of that I would reserve for the afternoon session where we actually discuss South Asia more generally. So what I would be doing here right now is to open up the discussion for some of the more general issues, and also very briefly sort of take forward the points that Mr. Sandeep Shastri has made earlier about the common goal and different experiences. However, I would only briefly touch upon right now and come back to that in the afternoon once again. The first issue is, of course, the methodological issue that Sandeep's presentation has started with, which is that what kind of context that you do your study is something crucial to your findings. And we entirely agree as a group of those who are engaged in this study. We are aware of this, and that is why I think he began with that. Let me therefore begin with this question and then ask a counter question to it. That can we then talk of more stable patterns of what people think about democracy in a given setup, in a given country? We did the first study in 2004-05-06, and the second study begins in 12-13. And in a sense, therefore, there is a context to each time of the study, and in the presentations on each of these countries, and later on in the afternoon we would come back to the question of the context in each country. However, at the same time, two things help us in talking more generally of stable patterns in a given country. One is the continuity of the same question, same framework of study, which in a sense gives you some idea of continuity of the opinions that people have expressed over time. And the India component at least shows, this presentation that Sandeep made, shows how in spite of certain ups and downs, there is a continuity broadly of people's orientations towards democracy and also towards people's satisfaction about democracy or the experience of democracy in each country, likewise in India. So the first challenge in studies of this kind is that of finding out stable and continuous patterns. And in a sense, the presentations that we are making here help us to locate those continuities very broadly, and therefore without going into statistics or data, I would say two things about this continuity. One thing which is found continuously between 2005-06 and 2012-13 is that as far as the goal of democracy is concerned, there has been a general acceptance of the goal of democracy in each country. That's one point. And while it might seem rather very general, it still becomes an important point because as our first report also points out, this has in the first place not been adequately recorded, documented, and in the second place, this has not also been given adequate place in democratic theorizations as to why is it that countries like India, but more than India, other countries, and mostly the countries which are still in the less developed category, have an acceptance of democracy as a political goal, as the goal of governance. So I think this is something that this workshop throughout the day would keep grappling with as to the acceptance of democracy as a goal in each of the five countries. The second pattern that emerges at the same time, however, is where Professor Sandeep Shastri's presentation closed, and that is the various inconsistencies in the acceptance of those goals, but to that I will come in a minute. So the first point that I would like to make is this, about the continuity and stable patterns of democracy. We must also remember, while discussing this question of whether people accept democracy only contextually or on a more continuous basis, and that is, democracy tends to produce a certain amount of complacency. In each country, when you have a stable democratic government over a period of time, citizens ordinarily tend to believe that things are doing all right and I don't need to really be very critical or I don't need to be very active. In a sense, therefore, the limited participation and the new ways of participation that citizens try to explore may be an outcome of this complacency. On the other hand, at the same time, we find that democracy also produces a cynical, semi-cynical, critical attitude, which we find in conversations with laypersons. And in our first study, in fact, we had done a number of dialogues with ordinary citizens and focus group discussions, which brought out this critical side of people's orientations to democracy. So in a sense, the study of democracy poses this challenge that on the one hand, we find out that the goal of democracy is generally accepted by people as something that they need, something that the country requires, something that is necessary. But at the same time, the same people, when you talk to them generally about democracy's experience that they have, they are very critical about it. So democracy produces this dual effect on the one hand of complacency and on the other hand of cynicism, which we need to be aware of. The second point about our study of democracy, and not only about India but also about South Asia in general, that we need to point out here is that consistently we have avoided any temptation to rank and give weightages, to say that this democracy is better. You know, you started by talking of democracy without adjectives in your introductory comments. I would say that our study also believes that we need to look at democracy and study of democracy without rankings. Usually democracy studies are famous and notoriously famous for the rankings that they get involved in. Rather than that, what we are trying to do is to only present ourselves and our data with this non-ranking presentation of democracy, in the sense that we are not here to say that democracy in country X is much better than democracy in country B, and for that matter even for democracy is stronger in one country or weaker in another country. We need to find out, as Sandeep's presentation on India suggests, what are the specifics of each country's overall socio-economic context that make people think of democracy in a particular way. And that is why this study, in a sense, would be disappointing to those who want to find out which country has better democracy and which country has worse democracy or less democracy, etc. In fact, there is an interesting question, and I'm sure some colleagues would come out with that, which is related to one's citizens' self-perception of the level of democracy in their own country. And that shows that, and I'm sure it would come up in Pakistan presentation at least, but in other presentations also, that when asked a question, how would you rate democracy in your country on a scale of 1 to 10? Expectedly, in almost every country, people rate their democracy from 1 as less to 10 as better, something in the range of 6, 7, 8 currently, and look forward to even better democracy in the future, which in a sense cautions us about this business of ranking. Then let me come to a third and more substantive point, again not directly related to data, but which one needs to keep in mind when discussing democracy. Most of the countries that we study here have a very distinctive character to their current democratic politics, and that is, it is extremely conflict-ridden. Nepal, the conflict is on a different question from the conflict in Bangladesh perhaps, but in Bangladesh you have two political parties which are not just competing with each other for political power, but almost look like perpetually in a conflict relationship with each other. In India, the two parties have a deep mutual distrust of each other, the Congress and the BJP. And in a sense, therefore, you have one or the other type of deep conflict witnessed in almost each of these five countries. And therefore, if context matters, then the findings that we come across and the possibilities that we sort of explore need to be situated in these deep conflicts. And I'm not sure whether one should celebrate these conflicts or one should be cautionary about these conflicts, because on the other hand, the critiques of standard liberal democratic experience everywhere is that there is practically a kind of convergence among political parties, and parties tend to agree more with each other than they disagree with each other, and it's only a matter of minor details that they differ with each other. So we need to take a call on this, whether this kind of a conflict situation is good for democracy in these countries, in the sense that it propels new possibilities in these countries, or it is something that we need to be cautious about, because that might lead democratic politics in each of these countries into non-democratic possibilities as a solution to those conflicts. If you look at those questions that some of us will be presenting later on, and Sandeep also mentioned those, why is it that people sometimes tend to believe that some non-democratic alternatives are probably better than democracy? It is possible to argue that people tend to believe this, at least some sections of the people tend to believe this, because of the perpetual conflict that they witness among the existing political players or between the main political parties in the country. So this is something which is still open for us to decide, and we might keep discussing that, and it would be great to have your feedback on this question as to whether such deep-seated political conflicts and social conflicts, both, because in some cases there are social conflicts, whether these conflicts are useful for democracy to strengthen itself, or they create further roadblocks for democratic politics. Let me come then finally to the broader question that Sandeep's presentation mentioned. And again, I would say that that is something, I would use a different language. He said that these are puzzles of democracy, with which he closed his presentation. I would probably believe, and this is something on which I have recently written as far as India is concerned, and that is where I start responding to the India part of the presentation that we are currently supposed to be doing, there are certain ambivalences in the way people perceive democracy and in the way people practice democracy. The puzzles that we come across from the India data show us, and Sandeep's presentation was therefore titled rightly as the gap between performance, the promise and performance. It's not merely the performance of political parties that one is talking about, but it is the performance of democracy as a phenomenon that one is talking about. Democracy promises so many things and people expect so many things from democracy, but at the same time, the practice of democracy is full of various ambivalences, as I would prefer to call them. Sandeep's presentation on India shows that India's democracy also has these ambivalences. While some of these issues would keep coming up, I would draw your attention to at least three such ambivalences in the Indian context, which they are implicit in the data, but which need to be brought forward further in the discussion. One is this question that Sandeep's presentation made about that people are not so much interested in procedures and rights as they are interested more in what democracy delivers, which is a great thing, and we have been arguing since our first report that this is something very important. But at the same time, does it also mean that there is less support for rights and ideas of freedom of expression and general freedoms? Whereas people would want the rulers to be accountable, at the same time, people may not be very much interested in protecting those rights, protecting freedoms of expression and other freedoms. And if you look at the way people respond, and we have a series of questions and data from time on a timeline, where when asked of this question particularly, people would usually say that more than freedom of expression, other things are important. Freedom of expression, yes, of course, but there are other things which are more important, and they are not just basic necessities that he mentioned. Those other important things might also be identities and their social ascriptive identities in particular. And therefore, if in the name of religion or caste or some such thing, freedom of expression is curtailed, people don't find it really very odd or wrong. Now, this is one of the debates that has started off in India in the last couple of years. But I guess it's not only about last 2 years. India has been facing this problem of limited popular support for freedom of expression and therefore limited interest of political parties in specifically supporting various freedoms as entitlements or rights of the citizens. The second, and again I don't know whether I'm contradicting Sandeep, I hope I am not, which is that this distinction between electoral participation and so-called civic participation is again very significant but needs to be further looked into and interpreted. Because while people are interested in civic participation, and various theories of democratic participation would probably tell us that this is very great, the ground experience in India is that as a result of this, perhaps, there has been a constant upsurge of what could be described as vigilant politics rather than civic participation. And this vigilantism is something which is very attractive from one angle if you look at democracy and people's democratic participation, etc. While on the other hand, it sort of obstructs stabilization of patterns of democracy in a given country. Which is also another ambivalence, I would say, that people believe that in the name of the people, some sections of the society can do vigilant politics. And in India, coming from India, I can say it for sure, and those who know about India, they can vouch for it, that various kinds of vigilant politics, called in India as fringe elements, extremist politics, etc., etc., are out on the roads practically every day. There is a cow protection force in India, for example, commando force, for example. And if it is only a Hindutva example, I must beg your pardon, it is not just the Hindutva example. you can find out a similar term of brigades and commandos used by various other groups in India, which in a sense is indicative of the temptation to get into vigilant politics more than democratic politics. So this distinction, though nuanced and might be somewhat politically complicated, needs to be made between democratic participation and vigilant politics. And finally, something that I would come back in the afternoon again for India, consistently shown, though it didn't come up in the presentation on India, is the turn towards a gradual, slow turn towards majoritarianism. So the right since 2004 and even earlier in 1996, we have been finding out that a certain understanding of democracy as equal to simply numbers, and therefore those who have larger numbers have the right and claim to politics, to power and to everything. This tendency, and I must again clarify that this is not something only about Hindutva majoritarianism, quite it is the national manifestation of this particular phenomenon of majoritarianism. Majoritarianism exists even regionally, even locally, and the larger point is that rather than democracy as finding out spaces for negotiation, there is a belief that those who have got numbers either in parliament or on the ground carry the day, is a limited conception of democracy which is gaining ground over a period of time. So these are the three things that I see as the ambivalences of democracy in the Indian context, and I would very much like my colleagues from other South Asian countries to reflect and tell us also about whether these ambivalences prevail in their situations as well, which would probably inform the discussions further, and we can come back to these issues in the afternoon. Finally, and coming from India, I can't resist this temptation of responding to this presentation with the last point, which is that these ambivalences, problems, these issues in democracy, do they come up to the forefront at particular times? And particular times they sort of recede into the background. My question more specifically to ourselves and those who claim to study India would be this, and more generally to anyone in a sense, is that in a country like India, why is it that these ambivalences become more visible, more problematic, only when the BJP, the Hindu Nationalist Party, has come to power? And is it therefore that similarly ambivalences of democracy would get a boost when a certain type of political formation comes to power, and does that have any implications for the practice of democracy in each of us, our countries? That would be my last proposal. So with this I will stop and maybe come back in the afternoon on a more systematic way to engage with some bits of the data. Thank you.
Parshika for those insights. Dwelling on the, we call the ambivalences, one of them being less rights or freedoms, the second being electoral versus civic participation, which you believe that often degenerates into vigilantism, and the third being the turn to majoritarianism. The larger point being that, in some senses, even though the goal of democracy is accepted, there's also a sort of cynical element to the acceptance of democracy, which is sort of off-quoted, the quote from Winston Churchill, that democracy is the worst form of government except for all the other alternatives. So on that note, we'll open the floor to questions. Since we started with it, you can, I think, cut into the, take 10 minutes away from the time allotted for tea. So yeah. We take two questions at a time, so
first and foremost, I would like to thank my colleagues. It's always a pleasure listening to you, Sandeep and Suhas, for the freshness and the daring of the ideas that you bring to what could easily degenerate to an insipid celebration of Indian democracy. I particularly liked the evocation of the ambivalence of India's democracy. And I would like to ask a question. about the generalization or democracy theory that you can make out of the Indian data. Let me phrase it this way. I was one of the great admirers of the first wave of State of Democracy in South Asia study. I've used it often. What I found most inspiring was the daring assertion right at the outset that we are going to democratize the whole discussion of democracy, that we will not be bound to one size fits all definition of democracy that has been given by the West. We will find something fresh which is appropriate to us. Now, that assertion was inspiring for its time. But today, when you tell us that context matters, I start asking myself, where is this comparative analysis of democracy going? Is it possible at all to talk about democracy in a cross-cultural, cross-national, cross-contextual analysis? Because look, if you're talking about democracy across contexts, it's like a conversation among people speaking different languages. Now, a conversation is possible if and only if we can share our differences in terms of some commonalities. Those commonalities are concepts that should be invariant across contexts. The moment you start saying, no, democracy means this in this context, but that in another context, then you end up in the world of Alice in Wonderland, where everyone gets a prize. Everyone gives herself 10 out of 10. Now, that is no longer, for me, a comparative analysis. So, is it the case then that in the second wave of democracy study, one is moving away from conceptual analysis to understanding the social, political, economic conditions that might give a feeling to democracy in a particular context? The second question in the same vein would be about trust. I mean, how can one trust the parliament when one finds how self-serving parliamentarians have become in terms of using obstruction of parliamentary activities for narrowly partisan ends? They have no problem cashing their daily allowances, signing the register, and then making sure that the parliament remains paralyzed. And when you tell me that people trust this institution, I then ask myself, are we back in the world of Alice in Wonderland again, that Indian parliament is important, let's give it a good grade? The first one was for Sohas, the second one was for Sandeep actually.
Thank you. I've got a fairly banal question to Professor Shastri. I was wondering if the data that you have allows you to take a more granular view of how perceptions are shaped. Specifically, are you bringing it up across states, across socioeconomic groups, across religious groups? That money that give insights into the efficacy of local institutions of the panchayat, or that's working across states of the zila parishads. Thank you.
I think I would agree with you, and I would say that no, we are not doing deviating from the larger challenge, nor are we saying that comparisons are not possible. We talk of context mainly, and I'm sure Sandeep would also add to this, mainly in order to understand the pattern. You know, there are two ways of saying, when you come across data, you can say one point, namely that democracy in India has gone up or gone down compared to, let's say, 2005. Which is fine, because after all you find that people are not satisfied with the way democracy functions as compared to 2005, etc. Second challenge is then how do you explain this? And And I think it is there that the context comes in, into the picture. One is not saying that everything, everywhere, whatever happens is democratic because after all the context is different. No. In fact, we continue with the first report in our assertion that there are limits to culturalist explanations, and there are also limits to saying that there is particularity in every country. So we are not deviating from that. It's only that we are cautioning about the explanatory factors when we say that this is happening in these countries. And second is the temporality. The temporal thing is very important. Because we are now doing it for the second time, we have to have a double comparison. One comparison is of course across each other. The other comparison is with oneself as to what people were saying earlier. And that would also ultimately tell us, and that's something that we are still working on, as to what is the continuity in those patterns, so that we can then say that there is a certain stable pattern. Let's take this example, for instance, of the meaning of democracy. The meaning of democracy remains more or less stable, I would argue, from 2004-05 to 2012-13, which is that people are more interested in the ability and possibility that democracy would produce basic necessities or fulfill basic necessities. It is that promise of democracy which allures people to democracy, rather than the constitutional document and the reference points of procedures that one comes across in different in a given situation. But anyway, I am sure Sandeep would probably throw more light on this, because it started with that after all.
When I heard Swasbhai, I was lulled into a complacency that I would not have to say much, and then he came up with the last word. To respond to Professor Mitra's very, 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 very valid question, let me take the argument that Swasji made a little forward. I endorse the point that he made, that when we said as part of our analysis that context matters, it was not meant to justify trends or to provide explanations, rational explanations for why something happened. And if you look at our report, we actually don't do that. To a certain extent, what is attempted when saying that context matters is when we are explaining a particular development, when I'm explaining why is there continued indifference, when I'm trying to find an answer as to why is it that on occasions people say it's okay for a non-democratic regime to be there. Now, while asserting the fact that this trend is present, we are also trying to explain that in terms of what happened around the time that this particular survey was conducted. So, beyond a shadow of doubt, we are hoping that SPSA2 will help us take our conceptual analysis forward. But even as we undertake this conceptual analysis, our hope is that the rigor which goes with this analysis would permit us also to look at what possibly explains why a respondent says what she says or he says at a given time. So, but of course, the caution which Professor Mitra has alerted us to will constantly be at the back of our minds as we take this analysis forward. Now, this question on trust in parliament, 13% trust. I also felt the same with a stonewalling parliament, with a non-functioning parliament, with an obstructive parliament. How does this happen? And then as I thought about it, there was and in discussions with people, what came up was two, three things. One, when citizens perceive parliament, are they specifically looking at an institution we are talking about? Or are they looking at whom they sent from their constituency to be part of that institution? I suspect somewhere it is much more of the second. And studies of late have found that this whole perception of what you think your elected representative should do has actually undergone quite a change. You're not looking at him or her as somebody who takes part in very informed debates on legislation. But you're looking at what that elected representative does for you back in your constituency. How involved are they? How approachable are they? How present are they? And studies have shown actually that quite a few elected representatives do reasonably well on that count. Our studies have also found that elected representatives who manage to gain re-election is linked to the fact as to how do citizens perceive them as having done in an earlier round. So, somewhere is this rising trust in parliament a reflection of how citizens looked at their elected representative who they had sent at a given point of time to the institution. So, that's one strand that seems to emerge to be able to explain why people take this particular position. On the last question about the levels of analysis which this study allows us to do. Now, among the different studies that we have done over the last 15 years now, a critical factor which has defined the number of people we cover in the survey is linked to the level of analysis we want to take. Like when we do our national election studies, our sample size in every state is such that it allows us to do a very detailed analysis of the result in every state, including the smallest states in which we do a survey. State of Democracy in South Asia study, the sample size in India, nationally representative sample, but a nationally representative sample of 6,043, which is relatively a smaller size. So, when it comes to explaining what's happening in the smaller states of the country, this sample size may not permit us to do it. But then, the sample size does permit us to look at important demographic differences. So in this study, on what issues do women think differently as compared to men, we have highlighted that. I did say as part of my presentation how among the scheduled castes and scheduled tribes, the intensity of democratic orientation was something I talked about. So, when it comes to specific demographic variables, we are able to come to definitive conclusions. But then, of course, the study is done in 22 states of the country. There are 7 states we have not covered, but 22 states are covered as part of the study, and therefore we believe it is nationally representative. But in the study, we will not be going. We will not be able to say. Let us say, does the farmer in Karnataka have a particular view with regard to democracy? Because our sample size will be terribly small to be able to draw that. So we are constrained by the fact that we have a sample size which is not large enough to actually make specific generalizations with regard to local government in a particular state or a particular area. That I would say was not a brief with which we did this particular.
Have next and possibly the final round of questions. Mr. Raj, Arvi and Ben,
Sibha. Professor Shastri, an excellent presentation. The data which came out was very interesting. This issue about trust in parliament going up, I would subscribe to the viewpoint that you talked about later, that when you looked into it in greater detail, you found that maybe it's not so much trust in parliament as it is interesting my memory. Conversations with the members of parliament, I'm quoting those. Why is it that the behavior has been the way it has been in parliament in the last 4 to 5 years? Number one is that in my member of parliament, I see two aspects. One is a positive contribution by that member, the other is the negative contribution. And this, these issues, the negative contribution, is more a product of the televising of parliament proceedings. There is a whole constituency which believes that if my member of parliament can stand up on the table of parliament, tear his shirt, throw papers, etc., he is contributing a huge amount and he is actually representing. The other side, of course, is the positive that he helps me, you know, get me a school admission, get me a water connection, gets me a hospital bed, etc. So I, to that extent, I see the institution of parliament or the subset of that as a member of parliament to be trustworthy or my trust in it going up. But your data is pre-2013. Now, which means your data must have been collected over 2012, maybe 2013. Okay. Maybe that's a conjecture which I'd like to make. Maybe that post-2013 you'll find this figure undergo a change. Because post-2013 we barely have had parliament functioning. So maybe this would be the other small point is you mentioned of trust deficit increasing as the proportion of the engaged citizen increases, isn't it? But the dichotomy is how is it that this engaged citizen, especially the citizen in the urban area, his participation in the electoral process is doing? Larger number of people, of citizen-centric, I mean, urban people, the white collar, are now voting.
We just collect the questions. I just wanted to add here, actually, the trend of a dysfunctional parliament. It was in 2012, I believe, the winter session. It was entirely washed up. So, you know, it's kind of contradictory that the survey was done in 2013. 2012 itself, we saw one of the worst instances of the parliament.
That was only one session. After
but,
that,
but an entire session.
After that, practically
yeah.
all
sessions.
Yeah, my question is about the kind of orientation towards democracy that exists. It would be fair to say from the data that elite citizens are more oriented towards procedural democracy, the issue of rights and protection of rights and the proper functioning of checks and balances between institutions and so on. So they see democracy as that and they value democracy for that reason, and their involvement in electoral politics and so on is sense is galvanized or motivated by that kind of orientation towards democracy. Whereas, I think I heard you say that non-elite citizens, perhaps, are far more oriented towards what we call substantive democracy, the delivery of welfare and social justice and so on, and are not terribly oriented towards proceduralism. Is that a fair statement then, that in fact, between the elite and the non-elite, there's quite a huge gap in terms of what they think about democracy, why they support democracy, what they expect from democracy, what galvanizes them to be involved in democratic processes.
Thanks, Roger. Professor Suha, a very interesting point you made about freedom of expression part. It seems to suggest that in India, there's very little tolerance for or expression. Yeah. I think the relationship we talk about, how people think protection of identity is very important. So you cannot say bad things about my faith, for example. On one level, that's, again, I don't want Mitra say we can compare, should compare. But that's a global phenomenon, right? I mean, there's a very, very small minority of people globally who will say you should be allowed to say whatever you want, right? So again, then, I was thinking, saying that in India that that doesn't have kind of support, maybe is not saying much, just funny. And related to that is Professor Sandeep's point. I was wondering in relation to that, people's perception of the media. I mean, you talked about the courts, the army, the police, parliament. Because the media also is, it says quite paradoxical, right? Because people think are very evil people, sorry Roger. But then on the other hand, people still consume it, right? There must be a market for it to be consumed 24/7 and having social media. For me, Professor Sandeep can talk a bit about that. Thank you.
Has to be
Let me start with the last question. In our elected and non-elected institutions, we had a big debate as to what all should be there. And we took a call that media should not be there. We did not include the media as part of that. But then, as you said, given the developments of the last year or two and the increasing role that the media is having to play, possibly it should figure somewhere, sometime. But I must add another dimension which does figure. We make this very important distinction between perceptions of people who have high media exposure, limited media exposure, and no media exposure. And there we see very clear differences in terms of attitudes towards developments in politics, towards institutions, among those with high media exposure, medium media exposure, and no media exposure. That's something we do tap as part of us. Professor Gandhi Bajpayee's point is important, interesting, and I would endorse that yes, the elite versus mass difference is linked to this privileging of the procedural versus the substantive. But then, just pushing the point a bit further, I wonder whether for the elite, even the privileging of the procedural dimension of democracy is more a facade, is more a mask. Because now it seems to have plateaued. But from 96, when we did our studies, we did find this, that voter participation was much more when it came to rural, less educated, less socially economically privileged voters. So the fact that if you were urban, if you were more educated, if you were socially and economically privileged, the less likely you were. So if we were to believe that the elite felt the procedural dimensions of democracy were critical, a natural corollary to that would have been that we would have seen them more in those procedural dimensions, which actually is not true. Now, for the masses, I believe, while they are enthusiastic about the procedural dimensions of democracy, they are more critical in terms of looking at the substantive dimensions of democracy actually playing out and revealing themselves. So it's not that they are lukewarm to the procedural aspects, they are enthusiastic there too, but they believe that the real success of democracy would lie in the substantive dimensions actually reflecting itself in what happens. Now, going back to this question on parliament, let me add here quickly a linked study that we did. In my state, we have 28 elected members of parliament. We did a small study across two terms. What was their contribution? And we actually compared it with the members of parliament from Suhas Bhai state, and they did actually much better. In my state, there were 5 members of parliament in both terms who never were heard in parliament for 5 years. Not even a single start question, not even a single debate, not even a single calling attention. Only 15 of the 28 members of parliament had raised a question during question. 4 of them were supposed to have raised the question but were mysteriously absent on the day that names was called. 5 years. We presented this, and the said members of parliament threatened to file a defamation case. And you know the issue they raised? Where does it say that as a member of parliament I must be present in parliament alone? Come with me to my constituency, talk to my voters, and ask them whether actually I work for them or not. And these 5 people who had never spoken in parliament were actually writing what they said. The groundswell of support that they had in their constituencies was leading to When parliament session was on, these people are busy networking across various government departments as to what needs to be done for their constituents. The question I am raising is, do voters and the newly elected representatives have a new way of looking at their role today? Are we being critical of them because we expect them to do something which they and their representatives and their voters don't expect them to do anymore? And for me, this whole, and I need to look at this much more in detail, is this 13% rise linked to some of these factors? Is it linked to the fact that there is this changing perception in terms of how you expect your elected representative? Finally, yes, urban areas, greater participation, electoral and non-electoral activities. Same urban areas, greater cynicism about the way the process functions. Some would persuade us to believe that this is because you have experienced it and therefore you are cynical about it. My reflection is a little different. I would believe that participation is there, but that participation also produces an element of indifference. Because again, urban participation is much more in non-electoral activities than in electoral activities. More keeping in mind what would interest them and benefit them. But when it comes to the formal political process, I would argue there is much more indifference towards what is happening. And that indifference produces this hiatus between participating and not participating.
Yes, I agree entirely that it's nothing special about India. I'm not saying that there is something very special happening to India. And in fact, therefore, generally, I would tend to believe that this intrusion of non-democratic spaces in democratic practice and perceptions of democracy is something that we need to generalize and look at rather than only blaming one country or that country's politics. And if time permits, can I say just one small thing about this trust issue? You know, we have spent a lot of time on why people trust parliament much more, and I don't have to contribute anything to that. But my colleagues would also recall that in the organizational discussions, internal discussions, there was at least one ex-colleague who would keep arguing that he distrusts the trust question. You know, the problem is that it's really just meaningless. I don't know what it means really when I say that I trust this institution or don't trust that institution. And that is one of the wages of doing comparative study, because comparison means that you have to have the same questions which they supposedly ask in Sweden, whether they trust the parliament or not, etc. And ask also in United States probably, whether the trust, and there has been a debate even in comparative literature on whether the trust question really captures what we want those items to capture in a questionnaire setup or in a survey setup. So that's just a bit of a caution before we really worry too much about why people trust the parliament so much.
On that, we'll be ending this, that could be a round of applause.